so we're going to go ahead and get started today, and I'm going to introduce to you the persuasive speaking assignment packet. So for those of you at home, if you would take this out or go to the file attachment, and you can just click on that and look at it or print it out. So this is your last speech, believe it or not. Woohoo, right? Round of applause. So this is your last speech, and this is going to be a persuasive speaking assignment. And so today we're going to talk about the differences between the informative and the persuasive so that you don't do the same type of speech. So there's going to be a lot of instructions that we'll go over today, but the first thing I would like you to do is flip to the second page of the packet, and you're going to see that one thing that you're going to notice is that the outline format is going to change. So you have topic, general purpose, specific purpose. That stuff is all the same, right? You're used to that. But now instead of thesis, we have persuasive claim. So I'm going to give you a definition of persuasive claim that I would like you to write down. This will help you remember what I'm looking for when you get ready to put together your own assignment. So a persuasive claim is a one sentence declarative statement of your opinion or belief. A one sentence declarative statement of your opinion or belief. In parentheses, please write down, do not preview my three main points. Do not preview my three main points. So you're starting to see a little bit of a change here. Why would you not want to preview your main points like we have in every other speech in this class? Any idea?
Might lower the impact as they happen, fugitively.
So it could lower the impact, so creating some sort of sense of suspense could be more effective. What else? When someone's trying to persuade you of something that you don't agree with, and they tell you their reasons right away, what are you doing?
You shut them out.
You're shutting down, right? Or you're counter-arguing in your mind. How many of you, when you're listening to someone speak about something you disagree with, you're thinking about what you're going to say to them as soon as they shut up? Instead of listening to their actual point, you're thinking about your counter-arguments. Now, we can train ourselves to be better listeners, but that's usually what we do. Okay, so in a persuasive speech, we're not going to preview our three main points. We are going to make a statement, or a statement of our belief. So I'm going to give you some examples, and what I would like you to do is tell me if the example that I'm giving you is in fact a claim, a persuasive claim that I'm looking for, or a statement. Okay, so you can just yell it out. Many couples live together before marriage. Statement or claim?
Statement.
That's a statement. You should not live together before marriage. Now that's a claim, okay? There are many differences between Republican and Democratic stances on healthcare reform. It's a statement. Republicans have a superior healthcare reform policy.
Right.
Or you could say Democrats have a superior healthcare reform.
Right,
I gotta make sure I'm fair. So you're making a statement about your opinion. That's step number one, that's your claim. Now, notice I gave some fun examples, like couples should not live together before marriage, or what about Beefaroo has the best french fries in Rockford? Statement or claim?
Statement.
That's bold.
I mean, I think it's true, but yeah, that's a bold claim, right? So you would have to prove that that is true. Now, your research or your evidence to support that being true has to be objective. So you cannot go to Beefaroo and get five sources and say, Beefaroo says that we have the best fries on the planet, right? So when you find your research, it must be objective. So I want you to think about this. If you look at the outline, your claim changes. It's now a claim and not a thesis. And now your body starts to change. So instead of having main points, we call them reasons. So think about it like this. I've just made a claim, something I believe is true, and I'm going to give you three reasons why I believe it's true and try to convince you with strong evidence that it's true. So what we do is we use statement of logical reasons for this presentation. We start with our second strongest reason to support our claim. We transition. Then if you turn to the next page, our second main point is actually our third strongest reason to support our claim. Transition. And then we save our home run point for the very, very end. That also is supported by retention theory, that what we say last, our audience members will remember first. So there's multiple reasons that we save our strongest reason for the very end. So I'm going to be sharing with you a video this Sunday night or Monday, and the claim is, I'll write it on the board and I want you to think about this for just a second. The claim is, even happy couples cheat. Okay, so when you look at that, how many of you have a reaction automatically? Yeah, okay. What is your reaction? What are some of the first things you're thinking when you look at this statement? First of all, is this a statement or a claim?
That's a claim.
This is a claim, okay? Why? You seem pretty emphatic about it. Why is this a claim?
It just depends on your personal experience. You know, okay. Some people could have had a relationship completely loyal, and I've had other experiences, so, you know, that does trigger me.
Yeah, it triggers you. It triggers a lot of people based on their own personal experiences, their belief system, their upbringing, their childhood. This is a strong claim, okay? So if you were to do this speech, you would have to come up with three reasons why you believe even happy couples cheat. And that is what a speaker did in a presentation called a talk on infidelity. And her name is Esther Perel. And I'm going to be attaching that video so that you can review it and look at her evidence. But let me give you some reasons that she stated that even happy couples cheat so I can kind of preview and prepare you for what you're about to watch. But before I give you the reasons, do any of you have any ideas about what some possible reasons could be of why happy couples cheat?
They get bored.
Okay, so they get bored. So I'm going to write that over here, okay? So one of your ideas is bored, okay? What else? Put yourself in that position even if you don't agree with it. What do you think people say?
Offers from single people.
Offers from single people, so sure. Temptation?
Could.
Temptation?
Sure.
Wandering eye? Lust?
I'm just saying others proposing to that person.
Yeah, so like another person is seeking their attention?
Right.
Right, okay. So others seeking your attention. Okay, what else? Yeah.
Maybe intoxicated or something?
Intoxicated, yes. All right, so drugs and alcohol, lower inhibitions, and some people would say morals, right? What else? Well, Esther Perel is going to tell you that a lot of people, they cheat because they are looking for a lost self. They're not necessarily turning away from their partner. They still love their partner deeply, but they're looking for a self that they never were able to express, or a different self. So she gives an example in the video of a woman who's been married for years, 20 plus years. And this woman is very happily married. She's never even considered cheating on her husband. And then a landscaper comes around and he has a motorcycle and tattoos, and they start striking up conversation, and she starts thinking about how she's always been the good girl and has always done what's right and been the perfect wife and has never had a rebellious side, and she ends up falling for the guy who's doing her yard work. And it's not because she doesn't love her husband. In her sessions of counseling, she tells her counselor that it's because she was looking for a self that she was never able to express. So it's a seeking a new identity. So seeking a new identity. She also talks about in the video that a lot of people that she has worked with end up cheating on their spouses even when they're happy, because it's an attempt to beat back deadness. She says oftentimes people, when they go through a tragedy or they lose a loved one, they start thinking about life and, is this it? Is this all that there is? Is the relationship I'm in the best it's ever going to be? So it's sort of like that stereotypical midlife crisis. People start asking, did I make the right choice? Right? Or the boredom one, okay? Another one is, she talks about, we live in a culture where our culture teaches us that if we could be happier, we should do that. So being happier trumps loyalty. So why would you stay with someone if you could be happier with someone else? Do any of you agree with what she's saying, that our culture teaches us that?
Doesn't lock the door on it anyway.
Doesn't lock the door on it, exactly. So I've given you some of the reasons. Hopefully I've piqued your curiosity and you'll hear the rest of what she says. So if you were to choose three main reasons why this claim is true, and we just had this to choose from, what do you think would be your strongest reason that you would think a lot of people in the room would probably agree with out of the reasons that I have here?
I would say intoxicated.
Intoxicated?
Because, you know, that happens, in my opinion, it happens a lot. People who are in relationships get drunk and go cheat on each other.
Mm-hmm. And they never would have otherwise?
Right.
Okay.
Well, there's another argument.
Maybe they would have, but the intoxication makes it so that they take that step when
right,
they normally wouldn't.
To it.
Mm-hmm. Other ideas of what the strongest reason up here might be? Yeah?
Seeking a new identity.
Seeking a new identity? How many of you think seeking a new identity seems like a really strong point that you've heard? Okay, so let's just say we did a ton of research. Now we have our reason, right? So seeking a new identity, we have a reason. We say this is our strongest reason, seeking a new identity. Now we have to support that reason with tons of strong evidence, okay? So we can't just say this and not provide evidence of it. Now we have to supplement her research. Maybe we saw her video and that's what kind of encouraged us to tackle this topic. And now we go looking for research to supplement what she's saying and support it further to see if it's in fact true, and we find it's true, and then we provide the evidence. So I want you to remember, when you build your reasons, you're using your main point toolbox. And your main point toolbox is FENTS, okay? F-E-N-T-S, facts, examples, narratives, testimony, and statistics. So how will you develop your A's, your B's, your 1's, your 2's, your C's? You shouldn't have writer's block ever, because you're going to go right to your toolbox and you're going to use a combination of all 5 of those types to build every single one of your main points. How many of you get writer's block when you have to write a paper for class, like a research paper? If you keep this by your computer all the time, put it on a sticky note and attach it to your computer and write main point toolbox, now you don't have writer's block. Now, as long as you've done the research, you're sifting through. Okay, A can be a fact. B can be a statistic. 1 and 2 can be stories or examples that support that statistic.
That's part of my slide. Just so you
yep.
Touching things.
So, support your reason with strong evidence. Now, how many sources do you need for this presentation? If you will flip back to the first page, let's look at the requirements. So this is an 8 to 10 minute presentation. So this is your longest speech that you have all semester. You do have to support the claims that you make with research, and take a look, it says you must cite 7 sources in the delivery of your speech. So here's what I'm looking for. I'm looking for 2 sources in main point 1, 2 sources in main point 2, and your strongest reason, main point 3, you're going to have 3 sources. Okay, so 7 sources, evenly distributed research for 1 and 2, and your strongest research is in main point 3. Number 3 says, of course, you are required to turn in your outline and reference page. That's all review. Number four, we're still looking at extemporaneous delivery style, so you're choosing a topic that you feel confident about and passionate about so that your delivery matches your enthusiasm. And then we're also looking for visual aids. Number six is new. It was not required until this presentation, but number six, your dress must be professional for the final presentation. Okay, so this speech you could dress to the topic or dress professional. Next presentation, professional dress is required. So it's a longer presentation. You are taking a position on something that's controversial. You're changing the outline a little bit. If this were our presentation, seeking a new identity would be our strongest reason. We would have to figure out what our second strongest reason was. Maybe we say our second strongest reason is people say that they're bored. Maybe our third strongest reason is intoxicated. But we have to do the research and make sure that we have strong evidence to support those reasons. Okay? Now, the last thing I want to say about this is I want you to be really creative. I want you to stay away from topics that have been done a million times before. So when we think about what is intellectually stimulating, what is intellectually stimulating is new information, something that piques curiosity, something that we haven't heard before. So I am going to ask you to stay away from speeches like texting and driving, drunk driving, organ donation, legalizing marijuana, all of those topics that we have heard a million times before. Not that they're not important, they're absolutely important, but we've heard information a lot on those topics. I want you to be creative. If you cannot think of a topic, go no further than social media until you get pissed off. And you've probably got a good topic. How many times a day does that happen to you? Yeah. So there's so many things that you can do for this speech, but I want you to do the unexpected. Do the unexpected. So if you come in here and say, you should donate organs, my first comment is, topic selection is expected. If you come in here and say, and I think I gave you this example during my first class, and I'm not saying it was the best topic for everyone in the audience, but do you remember what I told you one of my students talked about last semester? What his claim was? Maybe I didn't say it in your class. You would have remembered it if I would have said it. He said his claim was, penis size does matter.
Oh, no. I don't want to know his visual aid.
That was his claim. Now, I asked him to be unexpected. He was unexpected, right? Yeah. One of my students in my first semester of teaching, his claim was, you should consider going on a date with me. And then he gave really good evidence about his communication style, his conflict resolution, his values. And then for the class, for the invite to anyone who wanted to date him, he put his phone number on the board for his action step at the end.
Sponsored.
So, I mean, when you're choosing your topic, I just want you to think, do the unexpected. Now, you don't have to do something like they did, right? I'm not expecting that. But keep those examples in mind. If I'm trying to choose between you should go to a community college instead of a university, or you should consider choosing the gender of your child, which one do you think I want you to do?
Child.
Choose the gender of your child. That's a pretty strong claim, right? How many of you would want to choose the gender of your child, or the sex of your child, if you could, male or female? A couple of you? It's being discussed, right? My cousin Wes is a huge advocate of this. He wants to have a boy. He has three girls. My neighbor had five girls. They finally stopped. Some people may have valid reasons for wanting this technology, right? So do the unexpected, okay? Any questions or concerns about how things have changed for the persuasive?
So we don't have to do like the audience participation in this one or anything like that?
The audience participation is optional.
Okay.
Okay. You will see on this packet that one of the requirements is an audience survey. You do not have to do an audience survey. In the online class, it's not feasible for us to do a survey yet. Okay. Now, one last thing that I will say about the example that I gave, and if you choose a claim where you need to define things, make sure you define your concepts. So, what words in here would really need to be defined for the audience to accept your position?
Cheat.
Okay.
What all are they throwing under that subheading?
In that video that you're going to watch, she is going to talk about the different types of cheating. And we all, what I have found from my discussions over the years with this class and this topic, is that people have very different opinions about what constitutes cheating. Is masturbation cheating? Is being on dating sites when you're in a relationship cheating? Is talking to someone from the opposite sex when you're married cheating? Is texting other people cheating? Even if it's just of a friendly, platonic nature, cheating, people have very different definitions of that word. Okay, what else? Yes.
Happy,
yeah. Some people would say, absolutely, if we all agreed on the same definition of happy, this wouldn't even be an argument. So we need to define happy, right? And then one other word, actually.
Couples.
Couples. What defines a couple? So she talks about how people, even in open relationships, have cheating. Okay, so if you create a claim and you think that you need to define terms, make sure that you do that in your presentation. Okay, all right. So let's move on now to the informative presentations.